You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And what promises to be the most mankiest edition of the SWN podcast yet, that's the promise, that's the hope, and that's the prayer. I am joined by Community Pro Wrestling's, and just wrestling in general's, actually Pro Wrestling. Everywhere you want to see him, he'll be there being manky. It's Frankie Richards. Welcome back to the show.
How are you doing, son? How's your man, all right?
Not too bad. I said welcome back like you've been on before, but no, this is the first time you've been on this show.
Do you know what it is? It's because it's took you so long to get me on, that's what it is.
It's shocking, actually. Yeah, it was one of those things where I was like, I like to try and get someone in once they're about a year into their journey. And I was like,
yeah, I understand.
Back Frankie, it must be approaching a year now, you know? And I looked and went, oh, shit, there's 2023. Oh no, he's been around a little bit longer than I thought.
But stop out, mate. I've been here, there, and everywhere.
we finally got you on, and hopefully we're gonna have a good old time. So if you've listened to any past episodes, you know we start with the most like generic questions, and then we just kind of spin off into whatever after that.
Sounds right, cool. Ask me what you need to ask me. I've made a pal on an empty bus stop, mate. Ask me what you need to ask me.
We'll get the cliche question out of the way and then we can move on. But what made you a fan of professional wrestling? What got you into it?
I think it spanned from being into superheroes as a wee guy. Kind of trying to, like, always envisioning, you know, you'd leave a cinema and you'd be like, you know, kid on you had like powers and smashing things like the Hulk or like, you know, whomever. I mean, I presume you're significantly older than me, my man, but when I was a wee guy, I came out to you know, Iron Man or whatever was in the cinema. And that just idea of like saving the world and feeling powerful and obviously being a massive attention seeker. And then it sort of spun off to when I was living with my grandmother, my uncle, who's, you know, younger than my mum, whatever, kind of like an older brother figure. He was into wrestling. I remember it was Elimination Chamber 2010. First pay-per-view I ever watched, apart from being kind of like, not just being in the wrestling phase as a child, and from February 2010, religious from it, because it gave me all that good guy, bad guy, bigger than life thing, the drama here, the oohs and ahs. That was, you know, my addiction, since I've still not come out of that wrestling phase.
That's the best way. I'm going to take significantly older. I mean, I know I've had a hard paper round in my life, but significantly was...
Do you know what it is? It's just because I know I look fucking 55, right? But because I'm only 24, you know what I mean? I need to let everyone know I'm still fresh, you know what I mean? I know I look fucking old. I'm still on the paper run, mate, you know what I mean?
All right, you're fair enough. I'm 34. Okay, that is significantly older. You have me there.
How rude.
That's fair.
You're guilty, bastard.
So, talking about superheroes then, I'm a big MCU guy, as you may be able to tell by the absolute clutter of shite in my room behind me here with my Tony Stark heart, I've got my Thor hammer, well, Mjolnir, got my Deadpool's about. Superheroes, we'll get to wrestling in a second. So, is it just the MCU stuff, or did you kind of move about Batman's and all that?
Marvel, definitely. Obviously, I think Batman's the GOAT. I think if you boil it down right, if you have the argument of who's the best superhero of all time, I mean, if you're talking to an absolute arsehat, they'll be like, oh, Batman's a vigilante. You know, a thumb isn't a finger. But it's no fucking... I think if you boil it real right down, he's the GOAT. Outside of that, when it comes to movies... comics, anything. I'm Marvel through and through, definitely. But I've barely read a DC comic, but I've read several Marvel graphic novels, and then obviously all the MCU stuff.
Yeah, I mean Batman. I know why Batman is like. I mean, even though his power is money, But generally, he is as close to an everyman superhero because he doesn't have powers. He has discipline. Yeah. He has gadgets and all that kind of stuff, and that's just cool. I mean, I'm a Spider-Man guy, but that's because
he's my original goal. Obviously, when I talk about Wire movies and stuff, he was the first. He was my first love.
But I think that's probably your two most popular superheroes of all time now. And everyone's got. If you get tattoos generally, and you're nerds like us, then it's got to be Marvel related somewhere.
Yes.
So, what's have you got one? Have you got a Marvel?
No, yet. But my sister's a tattoo artist, so I've got one in progress here that I don't know if you can see, but it's gonna. I will be. Once I finish this project, definitely superhero stuff. Because how could I not? How dare I not?
I know. I think mine's just like a hodgepodge of stuff. Now it's
aye.
I've used hodgepodge twice in this podcast. I think it's only two times I've used it. Yeah,
plastered on you.
I just like things that are colourful and cartoony and nerdy. So I'm just like, I'll do.
Mine's. I don't know if I'll go coloured because Randy Orton's my goat. Hence why I wanted sleeves. Which is a big influence. So I've got several skulls, and I'll increase the amount of skulls I've got tattooed on me. But that's. I don't think I'll do coloured as much as they're nice.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, they look so out of place. Like especially if you're wanting to like move any further up where you are wrestling wise. If you don't, if you have a bunch of stuff that's copyrighted, then you're going to see the CM Punk action figures and stuff like that, where half of its tattoos are just like blobs because you kind of put that stuff out because it's copyrighted and all that kind of thing. Mentioned Randy Orton, yeah, it just reminds me of his Royal Rumble promo thing where he was just like the speed dating thing, and he goes, that's a skull.
I don't remember that.
Anyway, so you said Randy Orton, that was your guy there. Was that the guy, I can't remember what the card was, Illumination 2010, but was Orton one of the guys you just caught your eye?
The card was actually, it wasn't even from that, it was even when I was like, let's just use six, and all we boys are by default just into wrestling and other things. Mm-hmm. But I moved around a lot for whatever reasons when I was younger. So I didn't collect a lot of toys or whatever, from moving about and losing things in transit. Let's say I remember saying like my dad had took me down the Barras one time, and he bought me one of the knockoff fucking posters. It just got like the Raw label on people's faces and whatever, And I remember thinking, I don't know what it was that attracted me to, figuratively, obviously, to Randy Orton. And then gradually, over time, it was like, I was like, fucking hell, he actually is like the GOAT. You can talk about all his nuance now, like us as adults, and we watch wrestling through a different lens. But even then, it was just doing cool shit. And then when I got into it, that's when he's fucking hit that mega hot babyface run for the first time. But the card to answer your question was WWE Championship Elimination Chamber match he was in, where Cena picked him up for the A, and Ted DiBiase didn't know what to do with the lead pipe, hit him in the head anyway. He took the A and then he eliminated him, I believe. I didn't even see that match. It was actually one of the heavyweight championship match I watched from the Elimination Chamber pay per view. In 2010,
it's an interesting time because like a lot of, I've been around the block. I've watched wrestling for quite a long time now, and that kind of era is kind of like disregarded as kind of a poor era of wrestling because it comes through Attitude into Ruthless Aggression and then into that kind of weird bit. But I like talking to people that started there because that's the bit that grabs you in. And keeps you going, and then you can look, but it's that nostalgia lens where you look back at that point going, that was the best time in wrestling, whereas I'm like, 2001 was the best time in wrestling because I'm old.
Yes.
And it's just great that happens, especially when it comes to like guys that came back, like you speak about Randy Orton and absolutely nuanced nowadays, and then going back and watch stuff, and it's like, you can do nothing. You can do like one thing in 5 minutes. It's the best thing in that five minutes. I saw him wrestle live in Aberdeen, and it was the Wyatts. It was when he was part of the Wyatt family, and biggest reaction, supposed to be a heel. Biggest reaction in the room in the AECC. He did about two things in that whole match. He tagged in, then got a reaction, tagged out. and then tagged in, hit an RKO, tagged out. That was it. That was his job for the whole night. And it's like, Buddy Orton's the best ever.
Aye, exactly. I think, see, I argue with everybody, see, every time he does something good, sell, have people over. We watch the PLEs or whatever on the big screen, and then we do something. And I usually wear a wee bit of a juice, helpful juice here. I'm usually quite fueled up and into it. And I'll ask him, wait till he retires and then everybody wants to kiss his arse. No, you know, some people do, but wait till everybody kisses his arse when he retires, and I'll be like, oh, wow, he's the GOAT. They did it new, just as it's happening with Cena, where, again, you know, it's been a fair amount of years since we've come out of the It's Cool to Hate Cena phase, but like, even then, how long has it took for us to be like, okay, aye, cool, right, he's like the fucking biggest ever, if no, you know, top three. Wait till it happens for Randy Orton, because he's your favourite wrestler's favourite wrestler.
Yeah,
pretty hard to argue with that, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it happens with a lot, because Brett, I was never a Bret Hart guy. I was just never for me. But go back and watching him, I'm like, good God, why was I not a Bret Hart guy? You know, yes. Because he's just, everything is so story driven, and that's what Randy Orton. Not saying Randy Orton's Bret Hart. I'm saying everything's story driven. Everything he does is for the story going forward. Anyway, so just the your age is kind of throwing me for a loop in from some of my dates here, because when did you start training? When did you decide, that's it, right, I'm going to try and be a wrestler now?
So when I started, let me just think. So when I was like, moved back in with my gran, say maybe 14, 15, 16, and that's when, you know, I was turning into, I guess, a guy in high school, sex, drugs and rock and roll and all that. And then, you know, Grado and ICW and all that started going off, and the BBC Three documentary, and when it won who Jester was, and Dallas, and all these fucking names and shit. And then I live with my best pal Jamie, and me and Mikey, we were doing all the backyard stuff, actually progressing when that begun. And then even in his, like, you know, front field thing, his dad's just whatever, we're making up these characters and whatever. And then we found out about the school, because I remember just Googling it and texting this number and that number, and as as we know now, thank God some of these schools didn't answer. I could have been in a totally different spot. But I ended up in the asylum, and it was June 15th, 2016. Done the induction, whatever. And all the way till, I want to tell you, early 2017, I stopped and then come back late 2017. Done the induction again. It was then dragged out. And it had like 18 weeks or whatever, 18 weeks, and then back in the asylum, had several show matches. My head is too many steel chairs, as they say, in the noggin. But and then I believe I stopped about 2019. I was near a religious trainer. I didn't train quite a lot, you know what I mean? That's an ongoing joke. Mm-hmm. When the boys watch this, they'll get that one. But and then I stopped just as COVID kicked in, coincidentally unrelated to COVID. But I started to lap back to your answer, okay. June 15th, 2016.
That's all right. I love a tangent, so don't. I'll just let you go and then jump in when I need to.
But I'll definitely jump in, because I'll keep going if you don't stop me.
There'll be an hour up, and I'll go right my third question. But no, I want to go back a little bit to the backyard, and because I'm always fascinated by that, by the characters that people create when they're just like trampoline wrestling or in someone's garden. Mine was a terribly embarrassing name, one called The Bean, which was Eve Edding. It was terrible. You might be too young for, I think you are too young to know about Eve Edding. But what was your
Eve Edding, I know the fighter, he's him.
No? Eve Edding. Eve Edding is when we were on Bebo or whatever, and you taped up promos, and then whoever won wins the match. It was terribly embarrassing now. But yeah, what was your kind of, who were you in the backyard days?
So when we were younger, it was Mikey was Mick, and I think that was, again, it was kind of the inspiration of, I don't know if it was like Vince and Cena. Obviously, see, it was out of his back, his grandmother's back garden. No, sorry, he stayed in the same close as his granddad. So it was his back garden, right? But my cousin, that's how I was introduced to Mikey, he stayed on, like, all the back gardens were connected essentially on a hill, but when the flat began of the hill, it was Mikey's back garden. It was always his title belts and his iPad for the songs and whatever. And so he sort of, not ran it, but you know what I mean? He was sort of he had all the cool ideas and stuff. He was mixed, so he was like Vince, but he was also Cena because he always won and ever. And then I was Hellboy again because I loved Hellboy. And in the games, I always used to make him the Red Skull mask. I think in the games, you could have a mask, but your hair would still come through. Mm-hmm. So black spiky hair with a blood red skull mask. And then eventually, I don't remember how the Frankie Richards thing came about. I think it's. Something that I don't know why, right? You know, I was trying to throw things at the wall, and I was like, I only had that one character, right? You can only do like Hellboy and Mick WrestleMania fucking for the 50th time, you know what I mean? So we were trying to, us and like three other people, we are mad schizophrenic characters, we're trying to come up with more. And I came up with Finn Richards, probably just because Finn Balor was getting hot in like 2015, and then turned out to Frankie somehow. And then, you know, as we've gone on, Ravy David just called me Manky Frankie. So that's when Manky Frankie came about. But I used Frankie Richards very marginally in the back gardens. See, when I was like 15, you know, we were like backyard wrestling, but then I was also then going to house parties right afterwards and then whatever with whomever. I was in a weird time in my life, so I very quickly stopped the backyard stuff as Frankie Richards.
It's a very weird combo. It's like, what were you doing earlier today? I was doing some backyard wrestling. Ladies, or not, you here.
Guys, come on, you know, get off me, you know what I mean?
When you were mentioning it, I was thinking, because you're speaking about superheroes and that, I was thinking it was some sort of Fantastic Four reference with Franklin Richards.
That's just pure coincidence. Pure coincidence,
Well, meant to be then, I suppose, if you're big
right, aye, very full circle, aye.
So the Asylum days then, as when you first dipped your toe into the old wrestling world, and like I said, was it the documentary you saw first as you became aware of the indie scene, or did you go to ICW shows or affiliate shows around?
No, because I don't think I would have even been like old enough. I had went to the the infamous BCW shows. In East Kilbride when I was young, because obviously being from Willoughby, that was the closest. I didn't really like have money or nothing growing up. I wasn't really, you know, took out of anything like that. So it would usually be if it was close and say like Mikey was going, so we would jump the bus up, you know, pocket money. I would get pocket money from like my grand, we would get the bus up. The centres then we'd get like everything McDonald's or whatever. But when it came to like the big Hydro and all that, or anywhere else, any other shows in Glasgow outwards, no, I was never always to those things. So the East Kilbride shows were the ones I went to. And then I didn't really know indies until I seen the documentary. I didn't really know there was a fucking any Scottish wrestling, Glaswegian, anything.
It's mad. I know for myself, because I started this whole independent journey about 12 years ago now. Yep. And I couldn't believe there was so much around about, because it was Perth, I think my first show was, which is quite a bit away from Elgin, where I'm up and based. And then finding out there's promotions in Aberdeen, there's promotions. There was one that kind of ran regularly up in Furnessway and stuff like that. And it's just, yeah, it's one of those things, once you know about it, you just realise how busy Scottish wrestling is and UK wrestling is. But if you don't know, then you just, yeah, it's one of those weird anomalies, because you can go to someone, oh, there's wrestling on, there's some place this weekend, and they'll be like, oh, there's wrestling near here. Once you know, there's wrestling. So that first match I've got noted down then is not on my screen, because that is a terrible professionalism on my part. I will get it back in a second. So 20, Kez, I've got your first, and I've got some opponents I cannot name. Fantastic. That's an excellent thing. I've got Kez Evans is your first match noted here for GPWA. So that's back in 2018, coming up to 6 years ago, just over 6 years ago now.
Jeez,
that first match, then you did the induction. Did you feel ready for that first match, if you remember, way back when?
I mean, I always had a mad, it's probably been like, to usually being bigger. I'm a wee bit more mature at my age, and then kind of when I hit the asylum, I'm sort of, again, it's evident I wasn't putting in the work that everybody else was putting. I wasn't too clued up with being that age. I was that like, oh, so I need to be able to show to help out with this thing and that thing. So I didn't really get it, hence why I wasn't pushed too forward. So when I had seen these other guys on shows and that, I was a bit jealous and confused. It, all obviously my fault. I didn't clue myself up. So in my head, I was a bit like, finally, you know. Mm-hmm. Was I nervous? Where the curtain was to my left, and there was a fire exit to my right, and it was almost like, you know, like in a move, you know, like at the end of, you know, like a computer game where it's like left or right choices. Mm-hmm. I was honestly like, could I fucking run out that door right now? This is the scariest thing that's ever happened to me. I've been chased by the police, and shouted at, I've been in fights, like, but this, before the curtain, that was the scariest thing that ever happened, as much as I was like, oh, thank God it's finally happening.
Mm-hmm. I suppose, because if you're fighting growing up or anything like that, there's it really isn't an audience. Like, this is, the fighting's for you kind of thing, whereas yes, going out in front of a crowd, people have paid their £5 to see a show, and you're now front and centre in that show. Was that, like, talked about nerves there, but if being in front of people and performing in front of people and being that kind of extroverted way in front of a crowd, is that something that you took to quite easily, or was that something that you needed to grow into?
In wrestling, I had to grow into it, but in, like, you take me to a party or whatever, or you bring me to your family house for dinner, no, I'm usually like the loudest there, and you know, the analogy I make up on an empty bus stop is why I say it all the time, because you could honestly leave maybe anybody.
Yeah.
But I did have to have that conversation with myself, and I remember when it happened not too long ago, like, how do I get me more inside the character in front of people? Because if I could inject the energy, my humour, the everyman, as you say, like the how relatable and down to earth I can be into the character, so I don't just come out and be Wrestler 101, which isn't quite me, and then shit my pants right in front of you, then go backstage and hate myself because I had done the worst job ever. I did have to turn that on, oddly enough, for being such an extrovert.
It's strange, yeah. They say the best characters are your real life turned up to 11 kind of thing, and
yeah.
And folk can see that, and I've said this a couple of times in this season alone, but like, people, wrestling fans aren't stupid. Mm. Yeah, some of them can be a bit smelly. Some of them can be a bit too.
Some.
I don't want to cast a wide net there, but that's fine. Some could be a bit smelly. Some could be a bit too passionate at times.
Definitely.
But we're not stupid. If we see someone's being fake in the ring, we know. Like, we know if you're uncomfortable.
It's human. It's transparent, definitely.
Yeah. So, and once again, the season continues with the animal cameos, which I am loving. For those listening to the audio, we've got a dog. We've got a dog. That's very good. So that was it. You had a couple of matches, GPWA, and you said you weren't taking it in. You weren't really. You were wanting to do the wrestling, but you weren't. You were like, the fat fuss for doing the rest of it. Okay, the roundabout bits too.
Aye, you're right. Aye, I thought. That's a fair way of putting it. Aye, definitely.
So a couple of years passed. Pandemic happened, conveniently enough. Yes. So how did it get approached for you to come back then? Was it due to Mikey initially, or hope maybe?
Yes. So
Wanderer was
that. Aye, but this time he's the Wanderer. So we show called Rivals come up, what I'm sure everybody's heard of, definitely.
Oh, yeah.
Or heard somebody speak about, or heard somebody speaking about the infamous Rivals show. So he was booked on it, and it was his like comeback match. And obviously that was always mine and his thing. So say even we drifted apart as like teenagers, or just in life, I moved here, there, he moved it, whatever happened. We always swear back for the wrestling thing. So it was like, he would, whether it be we were with each other every day for 6 months, or he was just the friend you pick up the phone and talk to as if nothing happened, the wrestling thing was always there. During COVID, I think he was like, nah, fuck this, from whatever, you know, online outrage had happened. I think he was left a bad taste in his mouth. So when he came back, I was like, oh, fuck, this could be my pat in the arse to get back in here, because it was never nor the dream, although I was had zero involvement. When he was telling me, I remember I finished work and I was sitting in Witherspoon's drinking, ironically, and he told me, oh, you should come with me. I'm like, fucking aye, I'll come with you. And I went, I don't know what to say, you know, always bring your gear. Ha 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 ha. And he went, I dare. And I was like, what? And he's like, dare. And I was like, fine. Hi, cool, I will. And that was kind of that. It was, again, it was ironically all in a bottom drawer or set and placed. After all the years at any house I moved into, it was always in a bottom drawer. You know, very Mr. Incredible-esque. Because those are the colours I've went for, you know, having that superhero drawer to get the outfit ready. But it was just a case of, he had his match definitely. And he said, I bring you here. And I was like, we'll see what happens. And then I get put on the show because somebody no-showed.
So, yeah, the rival show, yeah, infamous, not so much for the actual show itself, but everything in and around it that out after and before the show. You know, the pride of African wrestling being on that particular event.
Fucking Wishaw.
So,
South Africa.
So you said off recording that there's a story behind the show. Yeah, what was how was that return? I mean, that's a couple of years off a bump, to then just be thrust into quite a interesting atmosphere on the rival.
He said, I think, so Mikey, I forget how Mikey, Mikey told me, so somebody's pulled out, let's fucking get you on this thing. So as we've come in, I guess we've all late-ish, hold on, sorry, lie down, I was freaking out. He said, somebody's pulled out, let's get you on the show. We turned up, the ring was already built up, people were, you know, doing whatever, rehearsing. And we went straight up to the promoter. And he went, listen, my pal's here. And he went, oh, thank God, somebody else showed. And he went, have you got your gear? And I said, aye. He went, cool. Can I throw you in with... And he chose the boy, Mike Illingsworth, I think. Illington. I'm going to butcher that because he was so nice to me. I'm sorry. You're probably not watching this, but if you are, I'm sorry, mate. You're a brand new. But he threw me in with him. He's from England. I done all right. Listen, I done all right from no training in X amount of years. Shat the bed. The guy, the DJ, had a very, like a karaoke DJ playlist. So I was like, my song used to be Flicking a Switch with AC/DC. So I was like, well, you got AC/DC? And he obviously only had Back in Black, Thunderstruck, Highway to Hell. So I chose Back in Black because I used to use that in the back gardens, you know. Then again, I was 10, thought I was the fucking king of the world. So when I've come out to Back in Black, yeah, I get it look so fucking cheesy, man. Kills me to think about. Thank God I don't have a recording of it. It was terrifying. And a boy I had went to school. Two boys I went to school with. Your brother was on it. So they were coincidentally there. I'd asked them afterwards and they'd be like, ah, you look nervous. And I was like, oh, God, just the worst, most honest feedback. That was bad, man. But I've done all right. I was just shit the bed and didn't get the reaction I wanted. I wasn't injured and I got on my marks and I looked after the other guy. But it was a lot.
It wasn't the return you quite hoped for.
It wasn't the return I envisioned. So,
but like saying, as long as nobody came out of it hurt, kind of thing. As long as your opponent was kept safe and all that, that's a good night in the office in anyone's book. And like you say, there's no footage of the show anywhere, as far as I'm aware, except the main event. I've got a copy of the video of the main event. Other than that, that's the only lasting footage, I think, because they uploaded it and deleted it very quickly.
I bet.
People are quicker.
It was it's quite ironic that me and Mikey made a comeback on the same night. Again, kind of how my run here has been very on Mikey's coattail, which, listen, that is what it is. But that I'm very grateful for. But it's quite Cinderella-esque that both of us made a comeback on the same day. Well, thanks to him. And as I said, I get good feedback and everybody was very approving of my performance. So that was kind of the, okay, it has to be. Along with people like, I know, Ravy Davey, made the Glasgow School of Wrestling, being, him and, you know, Xander and stuff, being one of the maybe five people that were nice to me in the asylum. Mm-hmm. Messaging me before he started school, going, you need to come back into it. There's always place for a scheme boy. You know, look at the kids on the scheme in there.
I like the Glasgow School of Wrestling. It seemed to be a little place where the Dave Davey like picked up these lost souls of wrestling, yeah. after all the fallout of stuff during the pandemic and things like that, where people didn't know where they're going to go. Their school, they don't want to go back to a school that has not got a good reputation anymore. They want to try and, but they still, yes, want to be wrestlers. And Davey was just like scooping them all up, just going, "Come to me. I will have a place for you."
Uncle Davey, I call him. That's what everybody's caught on and calls him Uncle Davey now. That's what I call him. Oh, Davey, that's Davey. That. But you're right, I was a shepherd for a bunch of lost weirdos that we are, definitely. I'll speak for us weirdos, and we are all weirdos, and we didn't need direction, and he definitely filled that, aye.
We do have a question about school, but I'll get to that in a sec. Because we're speaking about The Wanderer, he did ask a question on the old Instagram. He put, "Tell the people who you owe your whole career to."
Dad didn't reply to that, did I?
There you go. Away and stage another in-ring wedding proposal, you little arse hat. Was your reply.
I'm hilarious. He has an arse hat, I. That's so funny, isn't it? I owe him everything, if he didn't. People ask me all the time, when are you turning on The Wanderer? Constantly, if I'm at ringside, managing him or whatever, people ask me all the time, when are you going to turn on him? It's not that simple, because he's my best pal. Mm-hmm. In a day, I owe him everything, to be honest, especially actually pro wrestling, although I'm easily the most over babyface and on the relevant shows, easily. Have you came to one yet?
No. I barely leave my county here in Murray. Let alone, I'll go to Aberdeenshire, maybe.
That's not good enough, but we'll get to that. But I, as much as I'm in that spot, it truly is all because of him. He looks after me better. Make a joke that I'm the big brother in life, but he's easily the big brother in the wrestling world, to me anyway, definitely.
It is, when I saw you wrestling Peterhead earlier this year, there was that vibe of going, he's just going to punch him. Kind of thing. You're just going to punch The Wanderer. Is that what's going to happen here? But it just never happened.
It is.
It's like everyone's got that pal. That's like, he's my pal. Yeah, he's a dick, but he's my pal. We'll get back to more Wanderer stuff as we go along. I'm very much certain. So Attitude Pro Wrestling. I remember speaking to Wanderer about this, and yeah, you were pretty much like one of the first names he was having there and all that kind of stuff. Was he a guy that he bounced ideas off you about actual pro wrestling when it was becoming an actual thing?
Still to this day, I know, say we get drunk and stuff, and then he wants to give me the praise. But you say, you know, I think I've definitely got fingerprints all over it. Whether maybe that's just drawing the crowd or getting word by mouth, you know, because I worked in other pubs in Northern, and then people our age and stuff, and seeing my brother's age or whatever, just anytime you speak to me, it would be that. But bounce ideas, aye, definitely. I mean, still to this day, it's all we talk about, that and aye, that, and just where are we getting a drink, or, you know, what did you do in the gym? But it all kind of all loops around in wrestling anyway. Still to this day, and obviously he's in charge of that, it's on his mind constantly. You know, I've booked it for this day, and I'm thinking about bringing this guy in. So I always bounce back everything. I try my hardest to put my two ball bit in, but I appreciate that, you know, I can only really give friendly advice. I'm not in his spot, I've not got the experience of being a booker or nothing, so I'm sure he takes everything I say with a pinch of salt, but I think he asks me everything, so he must value what I say, even a wee tiny bit.
For that first, I mean, you did a couple matches for Grassroots before for Battery Pro one, but when did you feel comfortable again that you felt like you were where you want to be in wrestle? Was it that first Ruggy Slam show? Where was the comfort level?
So there are probably because I come back as the first, what was it, Ruggy Mania was the first show. It was me and Luke and Sharp, and then it turned into me and Davey against Luke and Sharp and Big Strong Man. That was good, but I didn't, if I could go back, you know, I was trying to like leather straps and like angle and stuff, I was just a fat master. If I could go back, maybe change the aesthetic, you know, that night's probably one of the best nights of my life. But like, I get the big hand raise and the photo, you know, the halftime photos and the big rub and all that, but probably when I got that crazy reaction, and again, it's probably because I had like 60 people there to come see me, whether it be old people or people's wains or people from school or whatever. Probably when I get that big, you know, the big hey, the big hoorah, that was very validating.
I mean, especially like the venue, Rutherglen, I'm assuming that's the place you've been frequented anyway. You would have been there. I don't know the area, but I'm assuming you've been there eventually. Like say there's people that had bought tickets specifically to see you wrestle and all that kind of stuff. I mean, looking back now, yeah, you say that was one of the best nights for you. If Attitude Pro Wrestling one and done, didn't have any more, would that have been enough in that moment?
Definitely, because as well as actually the run up, I had blown my left knee out in the run-up, so then my match was, it got changed like 50 times what it was, or at least the thought of the idea it was. I think that's how it turned into a tag match with some Dipsy Doodles and stuff, but blew out my left knee quite dramatically, right? The hospital said wait 4 weeks. This was a Sunday, so I waited 4 weeks in one day. The next day, and blew my right knee. The first session back. Then, as my knees are getting better, I get something happened, must have been a spider bite or something on the inside of my thigh, my leg. I think it went septic, so I nearly died in the hospital for a very short period of time. So it was like an hour, you know, like half a day before they knew my poisoning in my blood. So we had all that, and then Mikey was like, why are you in the hospital? And I was like, I don't know what to worry you, and this whole shebang. So it was kind of like, everything that went wrong could have went fucking wrong. So to then have that and then have it go the way it was, you know, at the very least, if I was going to speak selflessly, at least I delivered for people who needed me to deliver, you know what I mean? So that's why it's validating as much as hearing a pop and getting the hand raised and whatever, and my mom being there or whatever the fuck, you know?
That's mad. So yeah, pretty much it felt like the gods were against you in that moment, growing up to the show, and then you delivered this fantastic, incredible reaction as well. So, that's incredible. Yeah, it's incredible that you're able to make it through. So, from that point onwards, yeah, your journey was on.
Mm-hmm.
Traveling between Community Pro and Attitude Pro and Grassroots, the kind of that triangle of promotion.
Yeah.
Play matches, play opponents, and getting involved really in with the Glasgow School of Wrestling as mm-hmm. well. Is this as serious as you've ever been with wrestling? Are you now part of the team? Is that the new direction that you've taken on since returning?
Aye, I mean, I don't want to call it my second run, right? Because obviously I was a teenager that had a handful of matches, and now I'm an adult. So I'm conscious of all the tiny things that you need to be, like time cues and, you know, what you read, that things like that, as well as I've got a good relationship with everybody. I'm confident enough to maybe help, you know, say somebody that's brand new that's walked in the door. Maybe I'm confident enough to speak my voice and help them in that regard when you're talking about the school. But I definitely feel as if I've got a role now. Definitely, I've got a role and a spot, so to speak, which is always helpful. That always, you know, even on a bad night, you go, well, do you know what? At least I had a place. Mm-hmm. At least I'm still here doing this consistently enough. Because I want to be doing it even more and more, you know, I would do it every single day if I was in that spot, but excuse me, I do it as much as I can, and that's better than no doing it at all. like I was.
Absolutely. And you're kind of ticking off things. I'm assuming things like teaming with Wander, even though he's an RSAT, we've established. But you get to team with them. That must just have been like another thing off this hypothetical bucket list that you had going on that you wanted to at least team with them. And was it everything that you was that just a whole day spent just thinking of tag team moves and everything that you've done on the trampolines in the backyard that you wanted to bring into life in one moment?
Kinda. Well, I want to say aye, but no, usually when you're going through a match with Mikey just screams the orders at you. The way Mikey talks to me in front of a crowd is the way he talks to me when we're going through a match. Wrestling Mikey is truly an arsehat. Mikey outside, he's an alright guy, you know what I mean? We go to the gym and we share some blueberries and it's all hunky-dory, but it's just usually him going, just on there and then I'll do this, and you've got to go. They go, no, you just take direction. But me and Mikey, that have only just started even recently, faced them, that was pretty cool. I mean, especially in community pro wrestling where we've really taken off. Grassroots is a wee bit further out from the Glasgow scene, Kirk and Tillock and stuff. So when I got to face him in like CPW for the first time, that was fucking wild. That was like a real light bulb moment. Oh my God, like, shit, he is good. He's really good because I've seen it as just my best pal in wrestling. But you go, from a critical lens, oh fuck, he actually is really, really fucking good.
It's amazing when you hear his voice, though. Like I say, he's just shouts orders at you, but you don't, when you look at him, you don't think that voice is coming out. And then he starts speaking like, Jesus, oh my God, right, okay, yes. Attention, I will listen, because I don't have a choice at this point. I'll just listen to
Wander. He's got that like gargle, that harsh rumble, even considering he's, I don't think he's even 10 stone, he looks like a fresh wee piss pad, but bodily, I mean, brand new guy, but yeah, he looks like a wee piss pad, but he's got definitely a thunderous voice,
So, back to Wishaw, you returned back to Wishaw last year as well, so that was after the Rivals show, no, it was this year you returned back to Wishaw, back to where it all re-began for you.
PTSD.
So, I can't remember when this Rivals show was in the space of the year, but it's been June-ish, May, June.
I forget, I'm sorry.
That's all right, I should probably know. But so about a year then has passed between that first Wishaw show and you going, and then you returning for APW this time. That year, though, what was the difference you saw in yourself between those that 12-month span-ish?
Well, I started using the song, I don't know how you pronounce it, La Mort à Jaws, that kind of kick-started everything. I mean, my first, I came out to Baker Street because I just loved the tune. That was a song I was listening to when me and Mikey had the conversation. When I was in Motherspoons, you should bring your gear just in case. Obviously, it's quite long. It's quite. It made me filled with thought. So I was like, I'll use Baker Street, Jerry Rafferty, whatever. But then when I changed the that started kicking off. You know what I mean? I think the song definitely gave me a boost in popularity, and it was me and me. I came up with the drink, and it was my massive energy linked better with that. I felt more comfortable in that than, because, you know, you know, it's like you want to like slowly groove, when, you know, at least when I can headbang and pick up a Wayne and fucking, you know what I mean, like stand on a chair and fling an old woman in the air, you know what I mean? Like, that song gets you going. But between that and shaking the right horns and getting the right advice consistently, just being around it, and then having the opportunity to consistently watch, again, from a critical eye, as a student as well, and then come back and go, why did you do that? What should you not have done it then? Oh, okay, yeah, but you see, just learning all the time, that was helpful. Being on enough shows, and generally just sitting around it, just hearing everybody talk about, you know, about their own thing, and fucking becoming a copycat and a sponge, mm-hmm. definitely helped. But I want to see the song, because the song clicked. Like, for me inside, it was like, how do I get that energy out? How do I become... you know, you're all right, big man, blah, whatever, how do I become the way I am with you now, but amped up in this in a professional wrestling, you know, scene, and it was that song, I think.
Because Baker Street, you can see Randy Orton come out to that, because it's got that kind of stride that you can make to it, and And again, getting to see you wrestle live, you've got this kind of, yeah, big energy. Like, you're naturally like this kind of thing. Your shoulders are out.
Big fat cow.
No, I can't judge anyone's weight, but you're broad shouldered. I mean, yeah. You're out that kind of way, not like in, like
definitely.
What nonsense I'm speaking! I've never wrestled a day in my life, but yeah, I could see the energy and I could see the character, and like when I got to see you, that dynamic with you, Wanderer, it's so interesting and it's so nuanced at the same time, which I suppose harkens back to your love for Randy Orton.
So I'm so glad that somebody picked up on it. I certainly know that now I'm going to be like, see me, Orton and Brett, you know, there's nothing like that. It's just a case of, I do try very, very nuance-esque things like kid on, everybody's looking at me all the time, even though they're not, mm-hmm. kind of idea. But I try that because it is, we never ever had to introduce that me and him were best friends. We were. And then even if you didn't already know that, that was so easily translated. It's so transparent that we know everything about each other. And I just tried to be like, well, how is it you would be with your best pals? So seemingly I'm like, you fucking quite shut up and slap you right in the face. And it isn't like a, you know, with two tag partners to shove and go, whoa, it's a norm that we would bicker and fight and it can get heated like two brothers or, you know, two dogs or whatever. I try to inject those nuances, definitely. So it's nice to hear that you picked up on it. Obviously, I'm going to keep at it, but...
Yeah, but it's a like I said, it's a comfort level, seeing the two of you, and like, you're right. There's just something different about it. You can see two tag team partners doing the same thing, and it wouldn't be the same, because there's just something about it. People should go, there's shows on YouTube, or Patreon, wherever, go check out some stuff with Frankie and Wanderer, because it is intriguing to watch for someone who's a big fucking nerd like myself for wrestling. Go check out, it's very interesting. So as far as like opponents, I've seen a lot of guys who would have been through the school, or would have come across through the school anyway, through CPW. The match with Sammy D back in July, though, that's a pretty big match to get at that. Coming back into it and get yourself properly back involved. Sammy D, of course, a former OTT World Heavyweight Champion over in Ireland. Highly, big reputation. Was that one of the first times coming back in? Was that one of your first opponents who were like, oh, now I've got to make sure that everything's right kind of thing?
Yeah, definitely. With everything down to the fucking the haircut that morning. Definitely, of course it was. But when, ironically, you spoke about the APW the Wishaw show, basically, you know, when they did the Ivy show and we went back, he'd faced Gravy Davey and I had met him there. And that weekend there was three shows, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and he was the import and Mikey drove him around. I'm Mikey's best pal, and actually I was in the car for 99% of that. He brought his missus over and everything. So I spent a lot of time with him in the car, and we got a lot on quite. So already had that introduction. So perhaps I wasn't intimidated by him, but I was so conscious of fucking step up here. Because even when I was watching him, and he was giving me advice, investing your gear, and he was telling me, you know, because I'll go like Goldberg, like before I go out, bring it up. But he's like, he doesn't like that. He likes to be down, and he's just watching. At a different level, so I was fully aware of what the fucking opportunity was and what I had to deliver, you know what I mean? Especially because in APW, right, I'm sure it's no saying, and most people are definitely friendly in the APW roster, definitely. However, if you told me right now that you overheard somebody say Manky Frankie gets the spots because his best pal's the booker, I won't faint, because it's probably got to have been said. So I knew that if I fucked this up, you know, especially see with Davey owning CPW and stuff, him being like, oh, okay, that's noted. Maybe we think he's here, but he's actually quite here. Let's bring him back a wee bit, you know what I mean? So I wasn't intimidated or nothing by him because I got on with Sammy, but I was conscious that watching him, you know, blank me and stuff, he had earphones and he was in his own zone and stuff. So I was going, oh, shit, right, this isn't quite wrestling somebody, you know, getting changed in a school hall or whatever, wrestling anybody, this is fairly big for this guy.
I'm not saying it would have been the first time, but is that one of the times where you realised that wrestling isn't a hobby or is it like a weekend warrior thing? When you saw him getting ready, you're like, oh, this is his job. This is the professional part of wrestling kind of thing. You're right. I never really thought that you would have. I'm sure there will be backlash of you getting opportunities because you're Mikey's pal or whatever kind of thing. So I suppose that adds pressure on every match you do, especially through the APW ones.
I think it's more pressure. I keep it up to Mikey because I kind of feel as if, you know, I would owe it to him. Nobody's said anything to my face, obviously. But if I were to hear it, you know what I mean, again, it would have shocked me or whatever. And to be fair, roles reversed, am I likely to be like, oh, well, he's probably only getting it. You know, am I likely to make those assumptions as a human? Probably, which is fine. But the pressure more comes that I don't want to let him down. You know, because the private discussions that we have and stuff, and I don't ever want it to be, oh, because you're my pal, dude. I don't want that bad pity opportunity either.
Yeah.
But the Sammy match, he was like fucking Brit, and then Sammy had nothing. You know, but a good reception to it, and it was smooth, and it was, you know, slow enough, and I'm super happy with that match. I'm super proud to bring somebody into my home and stick it on YouTube and watch them or show one of my young nephews or whatever. I'm very proud of that match because I was able to hang. Was it all him? Aye, obviously. Was I good enough to hang? Yes.
I mean, like I said, I'm really just going all the way back to July because I got to see him. So I base a lot of my, because I can watch matches on YouTube, but it doesn't feel the same unless I actually see it. You know, and like, I can't remember what I said in the whole, I did a road trip episode of the podcast for it and everything like that. I did write up and all that kind of stuff. I just remember I really enjoyed you as an act. I thought it could be mankier. I think that was my only kind of criticism. I was like, I want you to be mankier, to be Manky Frankie, but I don't know how. I was like, pity city.
Right, okay. Throw
the old nasty boys, you know, the old face into the armpit kind of thing. I was like,
right,
stuff that in, you know, just make it mankier. But generally, I really enjoyed what I saw of seeing you for the first time. So, especially again with that dynamic with Wanderer and Darrow being an absolute law unto himself when it comes to throwing his body in places and stuff like that. He's a bit of a wild card, is Darrow.
he's one of my boys as well. I love him. And we started, I think he was my second induction on the first day, and we've been pals ever since because like minded in the sense that we're scatterbrains. Somehow, him way worse than me. But I, you know, a pair of nut jobs, but you're right, he's reckless in and out of the ring, man, he's nuts.
And I mean, that night you ended up fighting onto the football pitch of Peterhead Football Club. So that was I mean, you wrestling in football clubs seems to start being a thing with things like Anarchy the Akis and stuff like that, shows you're being involved with, end up fighting on football pitches. But bar that aside, let's talk about Hornswoggle. Or Swoggle. This was Ruggy series this past month. Oh, we're in October. A month or two ago in August. The Ruggy series. So big night. Probably the biggest match in APW history at that point, with the amount of people involved and the amount of things that were on the line and stuff like that. Getting with a guy like Swoggle, then, who's got a lot of history, a lot of people that he's spoken to, and to be able to pass on some nuggets of information. What was that experience in general, having him involved over that weekend?
Aye, mad. Again, Mikey being the chauffeur, me being the best friend, got to sit in the back and hear him talk about, oh, you know, one time I was with, you know, Kofi Kingston and did it, and hearing all these mad stories that, you know, pinch yourself because it sounds fake. You can't. Help yourself, but initially be the fan, be like, oh, oh. Now you want to hear all the gossip and even the shibada stories, but that was brilliant. I mean, he took some time in the school and stuff, and I think we had that big week. What was the Friday? I forget. Govan Rumble, Hamilton Aki's Ruggy series. So I never actually got to be in the ring with him or nothing, I've spent a fair amount of time, and obviously as a day, I always need to get the import, a pint, a tenants, because, you know, well, you know why.
Yeah.
But it was fucking cool, and he was a proper class act, man. He was brand new. It was wild, aye. And I didn't get to do anything with him. But, aye. It was great to spend time with him, definitely.
You have to bring him back then, eh? You have to get swap him back over.
He promised on the mic, to be fair. He's like, I'll probably regret, he said something like, I'll probably regret this or something, but this won't be the last time you'll see me here. So fucking right, you know what I mean? Bringing him, listen, we start with iPads and Hellboy and all this childlike nonsense, and then me and Mikey were like, fucking slap each other and all that after the show was done. Like, oh my God, we brought Hornswoggle to Ruggy. It's crazy.
I mean, as I saw a couple of shows online, that crowd at the venue in Another Glen is mad. Between that
fucking
and
hot, mate.
That hot and the Govan at Fairfield at Govan as well. There's two ridiculously hot venues for. I don't know what is in the water, what's in the pints, what's in the juice that's in that place. My God, it's absolutely wild. Before we move on to the rest of the questions, we'll talk about Ruggy Havoc, which is taking place on the 25th of October. This episode
yes.
is going out in plenty of time. I've written down you're against Renzo Rose, and then one of those things where I've written it down and went, shit, is that right? You're against Renzo Rose, is that correct?
Correct.
Oh, God. just, I don't know why. I read it on the website, on our very fantastic website, that was the match, but you don't get those things in your head, you just go, I got that right. Anyway, so Renzo Rose. Huge reputation right now. He's doing great things in Europe, Ireland, just everywhere. Yeah. We talked about the match with Sammy D. Is that kind of in the same kind of brain space, that match with Renzo Rose? He's had a couple trips over for CPW and the like now. So I don't know if you've had an interaction with them before.
I want to tell you, the time that Mikey had faced them, I don't think I was at the show. So I don't think I got to rub shoulders with him. Because I would have remembered, like, you know, I usually try and introduce myself to whomever it may be and be present there, but so I truly believe that I would have remembered, so I highly doubt that I was there when he came over and he got a handshake with Mikey and whatever. Definitely feels like that, you know what I mean? Like, see if I'm able to Google or YouTube or whatever an opponent and they're no hard to find, then it means definitely something. Mm-hmm. Admittedly, if me and you were sat there and put on my matches, we would need to type in likely the entire title. We would need to look for it. With somebody like Renzo Rose, but I mean, I stuck him on in 5 minutes, seconds, not 5 minutes. Sorry, I stuck him on four or 5 minutes, but I stuck him on, found him in seconds. That obviously speaks to the volume that he's what. I watched him watch the match he had with LJ Cleary and stuff. Like, he's definitely good. So I'm conscious. I try not to be intimidated. With these things, I feel pressure. Because then if I feel pressure, then I know that I'll be holding back with this thing or whatever. So I try and be in the flow, cool, calm and collected all constantly. But I'm very well aware that it's another big one. But again, I know he's... I don't know, man. It's just when I'm in there, my heat's too big for these guys. You know what I mean? I'm too bulky, so I certainly won't be scared of them. You know what I mean?
So, I mean, this is a part of a huge, huge show. So October 25th, for those that are listening that haven't got a ticket yet, they'll be very limited. I think as we're recording, there's like less than 20 or something like that. It's like so limited.
Yeah, no way.
If that, so it'll probably be sold out by the time that this goes out. So Glenclare venue in Rather Glen. Loads of matches announced, including yourself against Renzo Rose. But we've also got Ravy Davey against the man that's haunted him. In his own words, the man that's haunted him. that took his mother. that is a line. In a show that I've never get in my head. Ravy Davey will take on
Steve and he's more. I love him.
Oh no.
But fucking
Ravy Davey will take on Suicide. we've also got international stars like Celine Ferry, who I had on the show. She's absolutely a lovely, lovely person. Lana Austin. It's a packed show. This is going to be a squat match. I've got the Halloween Battle Royal. We'll get a ticket if you can. Tickets are available at eventbrite.co.uk/attitude-pro-wrestling. Go find it. Right. Anyway, that's the plug out of the way. Got your match with Renzo Rose.
Manky Frankie t-shirts on sale also.
Oh, there we go.
Of course.
Get that plug in.
What size are you, Billy?
I'm a I'm a 2XL.
What was your name on it?
Wonderful. So we've got loads of questions on Instagram and that, so we'll get into them.
Cool.
Big Finn asks, who's the mankiest in the locker room besides yourself, obviously?
Oh, how did I go with this? Because you mentioned I could be manky. Being manky is actually an analogy for getting mad with it, rather than because ironically I'm a germaphobe. Could you imagine that? So do I know everybody who's actually manky and hygiene? Yes, do I want it out and out? Oh, I don't know if my balls are that big. Let me think. Daryl, because he's my boy and he's come up, he's definitely got a roll on for Christmas.
Okay. yeah, because you say I'm manky. Up here anyway, up in the sticks, up in the northeast, manky is disgusting. That's how I've always So, yeah, there's the language barrier, just in Scotland. So that's fine. All right, now I understand what Manky Frankie's about. I'm not going to expect you to do some disgusting things now. I'm all with it. So Ross Hauser asked one of the most cutting questions I've ever seen on Instagram. You have replied to it, but is your mum a cow?
It's my walkout, so there's a story for that. He's not just being rude, because God love Big Ross. We went to the Bams to the slaughter, and the idea when I had went backstage before the show was, I was like, so should we contribute? Should I be like shouting things as with the rest of that, or is that going to come across as him stealing attention? So naturally, he'd be like, no, get involved, say whatever, it's 18s. So I was like, fuck you, your mother's a cow. You know, the best Scottish thing you can say. But that's why Ross is saying that. Nobody's more, it was aimed at Mikey, right? So Mikey's more isn't a cow, and neither is my mother, to answer the question.
Can I start pop up? I was like, I've met Big Ross. Big Ross is the nicest person I've ever met.
No.
It's just one of my cows, like, Jesus, what's happening here?
Funny that you would ask it as if there was ever a possibility I could go, yes, my mum is a cow.
My mum's a cow. Absolute cow.
Mrs. Richards is not a cow, let that be stated.
My mum could beat up two sheep. That's it. Right. So we've got loads of other questions here. We've got Infinite TMH. With the question we've kind of alluded to going through, but what has the Glasgow School of Wrestling done for you?
Opened my eyes that there's that the school doesn't have, you know, it can be a place of learning and fun kind of idea. When I was at the asylum, I mean, it doesn't really matter. I couldn't really give a fuck, you know, who's going to hear this, but it was very cliquey, just as most locker rooms still are. Very cliquey, very, you know, when it's supposed to be the tradition of you go in and shake everybody's hand, and you introduce yourself, or if you don't, you'll get big heat. But then most people might just fucking walk by you, even though you already know them. And, you know, mad, weird, like, cliquey, antisocial behaviour. It's shown me that, just like you said, maybe there's a wee shy guy that comes in, there's a young lassie that's intimidated by bigger males, there's, you know, all these people can come in and find comfort. And somebody like E-Town from the VLs was like, there was no proof he even spoke English when he started. And then we would all encourage him, and that's, I gave him the name E-Town by like, you know, yeah, come on, see, we do something, we'd try, and then we'd get something, we'd all pop. Yeah, I'd be like, fucking right, E-Town. You know, E for Ethan, E-Town. Things like actually just bringing people together and stuff, like, because most people on the roster, or especially the school, probably not likely going to just meet in life and be friends with. Mm-hmm. But when the school comes together, it just shows you that we can all come together with this mad, beautiful sport that's wrestling. You don't really always need to be an arsehat, you know what I mean, and be antisocial, for the lack of a better term.
And I mean, antisocials, it's so weird now because speaking about Ross, who's very vocal, very open about his autism, and that can be a very outwardly antisocial thing to have. You know, mm-hmm. It's not necessarily going to shake hands and do all that kind of stuff. And that's just the way it is. Yourself, germaphobe, you're not really going to be wanting to shake hands
with
all these disgusting, sweaty wrestlers and do all that. So it's. I'm glad, kind of, I think, from what I hear anyway, like this whole pandemic thing has kind of phased the need for it. For handshakes and all that pish. Like, as long as you say hello, that just seems worth it. That seems to be it. Again, that's all I'm hearing. I'm not actually backstage and seeing it happen. But yeah, there's still going to be clicks and all that kind of stuff anyway. Always. So
in life, yeah. As you know.
But yeah, that seems to be the overarching thing about the Glasgow School of Wrestling. It seems like a very open and accepting place for.
Definitely, certainly no room for any like real judgment or nothing like that. No nastiness. Plus, everybody wants to go on and be better. You know what I mean? So it's definitely it's a place where you really can learn and then grow and come out of your comfort zone. Definitely, the community part is very apropos. Definitely.
So now we're getting to the real questions. We've got Lily. Uh-oh. Lily's got the questions. She's sending loads. I think this is the ones you're kind of expecting. Favorite type of shot?
I swear on your mother's eyes, I was going to say, what's your favorite shot? That's always what I get. Silver tequila, preferably Omeka. It's pretty nice. I work in the bars, so it's not always bottles of Mad Dog and stuff. Sometimes I put my snobby hat on. But silver tequila, I've got a hernia, so I can't have it too acidic, so I don't have the lime. If I really want to jazz it up, I just put salt right in it. But usually tequila, preferably ice cold.
Yeah, I'm 34. If I have three drinks, I'm dead now. But I'm a tequila rose guy. I like a drink that sneaks up on you. You know, well, it doesn't taste like it, but you have three of them, and then you wake up like 3 hours later, and you go, "What the fuck happened in my life?"
No, that's usually when I end up in handcuffs. You know what I mean? But fought with my mom, the missus, all my pals, lose my jaw. You know, I try not to black it.
Yeah, no, it's an awful thing. Thankfully, it hasn't happened that often that I remember. Anyway, we've got Lily again. Opinions on vodka, blackcurrant, and lemonade.
It's cliche. Everybody thinks that I'm going to answer this because I'm a mad alky, which I am, right? But because I worked in the pubs, it's just the modern, usually young lassie drink, to be honest. It's tasty, but again, lemonade and a blackcurrant usually fucks with my stomach. So I usually have a flavoured vodka with just lemonade, AU, Ciroc, whatever. It's nice, it's not bad, just as long as you don't get that fucking blackcurrant that stains everything.
Oh, I do like an AU. I like. I've got a couple bottles downstairs of AU.
What kind? What's your favourite?
Blackcurrant was nice. I like the bubble gum. Like I say, I think I'm a woman when it comes to drinking. I just like something that tastes pretty. And I really don't care about that.
Guy, I feel you. The black grape AU is absolutely stunning. Totally agree.
Best I had though was the black grape Grey Goose. I had it when I was on my honeymoon. I had it on my honeymoon and I drank that. That's pretty much all I drank on my honeymoon.
When was your honeymoon?
2018.
Oh, Mazel Tov. Good
advice. So I came home with a bottle because it was in the GT3. I was like, yes, having a bottle of you. And
Was it then? A fiver or something?
It was about maybe €30, something like that. It was ridiculously. Right. It was still cheap though for the bottle.
Yeah.
It was one of the 1 liter big ones.
I'll try that.
And give me a bit of Crystal Head as well for the Dan Aykroyd vanilla vodka. That's my
beautiful.
That's it. I like my alcohol, but it doesn't taste like alcohol. That's the
no. That's okay, the I need a bit of something. I do need to know that I'm slowly decreasing the life expectancy. I need to have that harshness to wipe out the childhood trauma. You know what I mean? To increase the mankiness level. Definitely.
fair enough. Okay, I've got 10 years on you, so we'll come back in 10 years' time, and well, I'll be 44, so probably like pushing death at that point.
We'll see.
So we've got Lily again. Who would you like to face next? So no Renzo Rose is coming up, but who's on the?
The prize fighter in me can't not see whoever the champ is. Well, I'd be APW champion, definitely. Because, again, I call the Glenky on the house at Manky Frankie built. Obviously, it's a Celtic club, but in regards to that audience, I truly believe it wouldn't be that without me. And with the back gardens that we wrestled in being 300-400 feet away from the venue, I feel it's more than Cinderella-like, full circle for me to hold the APW championship as an actual wrestler and a grown man, just as I did a wee guy in the back gardens. But I mean, if you're asking about dream opponents, I presume she means I don't know, because see, there's like we see maybe we've got the grassroots and it's true out there, and maybe it isn't recorded and stuff, and maybe I've got to say touch gloves with a few guys that maybe not a big audience has seen, but Caleb Valhalla.
Whoa, yeah,
definitely. I mean, how can you? Judas as well. I love Judas, but you know, you watch him and he comes out with a scrot on, whatever, and say there's maybe I'm maybe talking to somebody like my father or however, go, what the fuck's, you know, have that old school judgmentalness, and then it go, no, he's actually like fucking top five in the whole country, you know what I mean? But Caleb, definitely, because I think he's the funniest, very, very funny. I was going to try and rank him, right? Hilarious. And, you know, he's built a fucking house. Sweet guy as well. But I think I could tear it up with him, definitely.
Yeah, he's definitely one of those guys where, yeah, outside the ring, he's, like, so nice and that. But you know that once he's in full Caleb form and got the cape on, you're like, ah, oh, shit, you're going to throw me.
I don't want to cut him off in traffic, definitely not.
But no, it's the thing is, especially with the CPW and in turn, actually pro as well, there seems to be no... There's no limit to who you can think of getting in because, yeah. I mean, shit, we've got Suicide coming over. We've had Swoggle, we've had so many names. Gangrel was supposed to be over for Welcome to Mary Hell.
Yes.
But there's no limit to what Davey and
definitely, I definitely. I think I'd want to, you see, even a one on one with somebody like Davey, somebody like the Wanderer eventually. I see like these top guys like that to show, just so you know, because I want to get to a point where I'm in that discussion where it's like, well, the Scottish wrestling scene, you know, well, who do you think's the best? And then somebody like perhaps yourself would write me off very quickly in a handful of names just to get your point across. I want to at least be in the conversation like a Judas, Davey, Wanderer, like Caleb, etc., etc., etc.
That's a good goal to hit. Yeah, just being in the conversation at least. But the last question we've got here is from Lily, and then we'll do the old social wrap ups. We mentioned him earlier, but she wants to know, what's your real opinions on Mr. Wanderer?
And one word.
Go for it.
My best pal beats a fucking meat ass hat.
All one word.
All one word.
All one word.
All one word.
What a way to wrap that up. So, yeah, 25th of October, we've got Renzo Rose and Ruggy Havoc, Rather Glen venue. We'll get your tickets for that if they're still available. They might not be when this goes out. Where can people find out more about Manky Frankie Richards?
Instagram, primarily, Manky Frankie Richards, or Frankie Richards on Facebook, or still.
Perfect. Thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today.
Thank you. Are you coming on the 25th?
I'm not, no. I'll be there on the 25th.
My man, you're fucking letting me down.
But I will keep an eye out.
We come to the next one, at least. You're going to need to come to one of these big ones because I need you to feel it. As you said, watching it's A-okay and you can watch it on YouTube, but I'd like you to be there, definitely, man. Know what I mean?
The plan is next year, I'm wanting to, because I've got a 2-year-old, so I kind of want to wait until he's a little bit older so he can come to the show and properly travel. So my hope is next year I'm going to tick off some of these promotions I haven't been to yet. Year after, tick off whatever's left. Just work my way through. I'm going to get through all these promotions in Scotland. All the good ones. All the good promotions in Scotland. Eventually.
Three or four.
Some are a bit dodgy ground. But yeah, we'll get there eventually. So one day, I'll definitely be there with him and feeling the Manky force of...
That's it. Pick you up in my head like a Wayne and go, hey.
I would love
fucking Dave Meltzer.
I would love to see you try. But anyway, I'm gonna stop the recording and then we can have a chat afterwards. But yeah, thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you, I appreciate you very much. Cheers.